Welcome to another edition of Narrative Emotion. And on this episode, we're here to talk about engagement in story. What do I mean by engagement in story? Well, it's the awareness that you're not here just to simply deliver a series of facts with your audience as an artist, but telling your story as an opportunity to open a dialogue between both parties. How do we do that? Well, we make the story a shared and relatable experience. So today, my guest, a fellow Brummy, and those who are not familiar with that term, it's a person born and bred in the city of Birmingham. He's a musician, journalist, you'll enjoy this next bit, online satirist. I wanted to add that because his Facebook presence is often hilarious and straight to the point. And an award-winning Kerrang radio presenter. We welcome Mr. Johnny Doom. Good afternoon, Johnny. How are you?
Pretty good. I've just been out in the garden trying to put some fences up. So I've been lugging posts around and gravel boards, and I'm covered in concrete, but the sun's out and life is okay.
Well, that's good. And how are you finding the gravel boarding or DIY with Doom, as we should call it?
Well, it'd be nice to have a helper. You know, I'm kind of doing it on my own, but luckily my dad taught me how to do it. He's a bit of a kind of every man when it comes to doing stuff like that. So yeah, I worked with him when I was young before I started doing music stuff.
Got you in the shed showing you how to use his lathe and the hammer and saw. Well, that's lovely to see. First of all, welcome to it's a video cast, podcast, whatever you want to call it. I'd like to explore your story a little bit here today. And with all good ones, tell us a bit about what's going on with you right now, other than obviously the DIY. What are you up to? Tell us about that.
Well, I've been with Kerrang Radio now for 16 years, and through all the ups and downs, a lot of people know me as a presenter. And that's what I'm still doing now. Kerrang has done actually quite well over the last few months, more engagement because people have been stuck at home, more people discovering the station and what it's about, so which most of us know is rock, punk, metal, etc. And there's been more musicians stuck at home as well, not on tour, so I've had more people to chat to. So yeah, Kerrang's going okay, and I'm very happy doing that with the team, who are very nice. And I'm also a musician as well, so I've got various bands on the go and things like that, releasing albums. And like many people, frustrated and hopefully waiting to go out on tour at some stage. And also I've got a family. I've got a daughter called Lauren, who's 11. I've got a partner who I've been with for over 25 years, and a nice little house in the middle of Birmingham. So yeah, life's okay.
That sounds lovely. And I'm really, really pleased that. And of course, in the introduction, I cited that you're a musician by trade. And let's go back a little bit to 87 when you started Doom. But further, let's go a little bit further than that. We'll have a bit of fun with this. Right. We'll peel back the story just a bit. And the question comes in twofold. So this is the question for you. What was your very first record you bought for yourself? Now, before you answer that, I'd like to hear the rock and roll answer, but I'd like to really love to know my mum gave me some money to get this answer. And I'll get you started. Here's my confessions. Here's my first ever one, which is the lovely theme to Rainbow.
Oh, it's a good one, that is.
Yeah popular television series for the children's television series. Can't even remember what year that came out. I'll assume today because it should have the year on this. 1973, that one. And probably the worst one of all. Actually, it's a bit of a love-hate one, which is this. Paul McCartney, We All Stand Together.
Yeah, I know the one.
Those are mine. So tell me, Johnny, what are yours?
Well, we did grow up listening to those kind of novelty records and loving them, but I think they were hand-me-downs from my dad because they were things like Pinky and Perky, sing Christmas songs. There was Ken Dodd and the Diddy Men as well, which was quite bizarre. And I suppose there were other things around the house at the time that were kind of silly, you know, silly records. There was a lot of ABBA when I was growing up and things like that, you know, in the 70s and My sister liked the Jackson 5, but I've got to say the thing that kind of interested me, I think it was my age as well, growing up in the 70s, you know, when I was about 7 or 8, I started to notice punk a little bit.
Coming towards the latter end of the 1970s, mid to latter end of the 70s.
Yeah, and I remember the first things I really bought were things like Ian Dury and the Blockheads.
Nice.
You know, Hit Me With Your Rhythm Stick, things like that. I bought a Sex Pistols record and I felt really, really, you know, kind of a rebel for buying that, you know. And it was only kind of like a B-side, you know, really rubbish Sex Pistols record as well, but I loved it, you know, and it made me feel a little bit punk. So I was already gravitating towards, I don't know, the band things and things you weren't supposed to listen to and stuff like that.
So you had a bit of a rebellious ear from the age of 7 then. That's quite an unusual. I mean, for me, when I was sort of 7 or 8 years old, I guess I was listening to stuff, you know, very early stuff like Print, like early Prince, and bands like, because my brother was hugely into pop music at the time. So obviously you kind of like, you're influenced by your siblings. What about you? Did you ever listen to anything that any of you say you got a sister? Is that right?
Yeah, I've got an older sister and she used to have a boyfriend who came round and he introduced us to all sorts of things, you know, whether it was, I don't know, bands like The, and Misty and Roots, so some like reggae stuff as well. And he was the one who introduced me to Crass. He wasn't a punk guy, but he just knew about them and he knew lots about music. And I was kind of gravitating towards the punk thing. And then he told me about Crass. And then I started getting into that with my mates. And that became like the first big band that I followed. Even though they weren't a big band, you know, they were a punk band and they were an anarchist band, but they were really kind of different to all the other bands because they were so, I suppose, on the edge, you know.
How old were you at that point?
That's getting now more towards 10, 11. I went to see Crass when I was 12, actually, in Birmingham at Digbeth Civic Hall. But yeah, I was an early punk, but I also flirted with other things that were around in the early 80s as well, like Two Tone was something I really enjoyed.
That was a huge thing for the Midlands.
Yeah, it was, you know, and I remember being a bit skinhead looking around that time. And goth as well. I mean, I used to jump on any bandwagon back then. You know, when goth came out and I heard Sisters of Mercy, I was into that as well. I was a big fan of Killing Joke. You know, there was so many things that I was just kind of taking in the late 70s, early 80s.
I mean, you say these things like jumping on different bandwagons, but they're all essentially the underground subcultures of the city and arguably of the country during that particular period. Now, with all these experiences and different things that were going on at that point for you, this was obviously the point where you began to develop your taste and style as a musician. When did you start? When did you begin to play? When did you go, you know what, I'm going to pick up a guitar, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that? What was that point for you?
Well, punk, really, because punk, the punk ethos was that anyone can pick up a guitar. And it just happened at that time we were listening to lots of punk and hardcore, but then also punk and hardcore was colliding with metal really heavily as well. So the two were kind of starting to bind together. You know, you've got Metallica wearing GBH t-shirts and you'd got wearing Misfits t-shirts, and there was bands like Bad Brains and Minor Threat and English punk bands, but then they were also kind of playing on the same bill as some of the metal-y bands that were coming through, like Cro-Mags and things like that. And I was kind of right in the thick of it, so I couldn't play my instrument, but I was also around people who were forming bands. I was around Nick, who was forming Napalm Death at the time.
Yeah.
Well, he was already doing Napalm Death. They formed in about 82. But yeah, I was around them, Bolt Thrower, you know, early, I suppose lots of people who went on to be in bigger bands later. But yeah, so when I saw Napalm Death especially, I thought, right, I want to pick up an instrument. I can just play rudimentary notes, shout and be good, you know, because I loved that at the time. And we formed a band before Doom called the Subverters, three-piece, and we played at our local youth club in Streatley, which is where I'm from. And I don't think it went down too well, but it was it was the start of everything.
What was it now? Often, I heard a quote the other week, often with more presence than talent.
Yeah, definitely. At that point. You know, but that's what the punk thing was good for. It was kind of a little bit different to rock and metal, because rock and metal, you had to be pretty good to impress people.
That's right.
Whereas punk, you could kind of get the energy out and it could still be good. And also, going back to what you were saying earlier, where I'm from, being from Birmingham, well, again, you know, I'm from different parts, really, because, you know, where I was born, it was kind of Aldridge, which is near Brown Hills, which is in Birmingham, but at the same time borders on Warsaw.
That's right, yeah.
Where I used to go as well as an early punk alternative person, but we'll talk about that in a bit. And Streatley's quite a well-to-do place. Not that my family was particularly posh, but we just lived around there. And I was the paper boy to a lot of rich footballers and film stars and stuff who used to live around there and things like that. But yeah, I wanted to get out of the confines of where I live. So we used to go to Warsaw, to the Watering Trough there. I don't know whether you've heard of a pub in Warsaw called the Watering Trough.
No.
And number 19s, they were these kind of venues. And that's where the first incarnation of Doom played, you know, properly. Mm-hmm. In a pub there, and and that's when we started going over to Birmingham. Into, you know, you had to get two buses really to get where we wanted to go, but we used to go into Birmingham to gigs. And also, just outside in Spark Hill, there was a pub called the Mermaid.
We know the Mermaid very, very well.
Run by a guy called Darren Russell, who now does Rebellion Punk Festival. He, you know, he's involved in that in Blackpool. But yeah, it was kind of a dingy pub. It's big, but it was dingy and sold this horrible scrumpy cider. It was full of kind of old alcoholics. But the upstairs, it had this kind of dirty gig room that was quite big, nice bar area. And it used to attract all the punks, and also a lot of rockers around that time as well, who were looking for the faster, more extreme rock, you know, the thrash kind of stuff. And Daz Russell liked psychedelic stuff as well, and prog, so he used to put on bands like Cardiacs there as well. But yeah, the Mermaid just became this hub for all the punks and, as I say, colliding with metal. So I went to see most of the bands there when I was first going to gigs, whether it's Napalm Death and Heresy and Deviated Instinct and Chaos UK and Disorder and Amoebics. And then bands from the US came over as well, DRI, I saw Swans there. So many bands, so many memories, you know, because I was only, 15, 16, getting two buses over there and having to get home as well. I don't know how I did it.
Most of us, everywhere in Birmingham, anywhere decent, was always two bus journeys away.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, I lived over here. I came from Stechford. This bit of the conversation is going to be, anyone outside Birmingham is going to be going, but just to be talked for a second, Stechford. Now, if I wanted to get anywhere decent, like maybe like go the Green Man in Harborne or something like that, but I'd have to get the bus, the 14 into town. It was the 14, I remember that. And then I kind of remember what the number of the bus was to get out of it, but it was always, you know, it was a two bus journey every time. But we made those kind of journeys back then. People did.
Yeah, and I don't know how we got all this stuff together before phones, before mobile phones as well. You know, you probably called each other on the landline or something like that, or made plans at school. I don't know, but it all seems baffling to me now.
You may as well. We're not very far away from smoke signals at that point, really, were we, in comparison to the technology today? Instant conversation. Back then it was like, you know, getting from school Friday, I'll meet you at such and such outside mother care in Birmingham. All right, I'll see you there in an hour.
It worked.
It work.
So yeah, that's kind of how I got over into Birmingham, really, and met all the people that I was going to form lifetime friendships with. I'm still friends with the people, you know, Nick from Napalm Death, Carl from Bolt Thrower, you know, Frank, all the people I, you know, was around at that time at the Mermaid, you know, and from the punk scene and the metal scene. And lots of them have gone on to, as I said, big things, you know, members of Carcass and things like that. They played all around the world. And those were the people that, you know, I cut my teeth with. And I was in Doom. You know, we were four Brummies and from different parts of Brum. Two of us from Streatley, me and Brian. And then there was Stick, who was from Druid's Heath. And then Pete as well, who was more the kind of Dorwich kind of area.
Posh.
Yes, yes. You know, but you were talking about it earlier, and it's a really good point about Birmingham. Is it's massive. It's massive, Birmingham. And it's full of suburbs. You know, you've got the city centre, which has got a few things in it, but there's people and, you know, little places that sprawl out from Birmingham. And there's no tube for us to get anywhere like London.
That's right.
You have to get buses, and people live on the outskirts. Some people live here, live there. And that's why it's difficult for Birmingham sometimes to get all the people into the centre when there are concerts and things like that, because it's such a sprawling mass that isn't very well connected as well.
Essentially, so. Still true today as well. I mean, they're trying their best with the tram lines and all that sort of stuff, but they don't seem to be getting anywhere. So this journey of yours in music, obviously, as musicians, it's sometimes you connect the dots, and we all know, you know, a lot of them, a lot of musicians, especially nowadays, obviously the last 12 months, I've seen a lot of musicians make the transition into radio. And this is kind of like they have a foot in the door because of the music industry. It's quite a natural progression for them. But what first gave you an interest in journalism and broadcasting as opposed to as a main focus to being a musician, or you still really consider yourself a very much a 50-50 kind of guy with that?
Well, even though we did well with Doom, I mean, everyone knows Doom, and, you know, they're still going without me and Pete, you know, and still touring around the world. But, you know, we still do music as a hobby. I've never made a living off it, even though I've made some money here and there, and I've toured around the globe. I've been all over the place, Japan and all around Europe many, many times. But yeah, you live a regular life. And in my 20s, I did a lot of bumming around, a lot of partying, but I also worked setting up stages, sound and lighting stuff at the NEC.
Okay.
And venues around Birmingham. So we used to unload the trucks and then put up all the PAs and things like that, make the sets. So I was working doing that as a kind of form of income, doing my bands on the side and then just getting trashed and enjoying myself, as you do. But there became a point after a while, I think, you know, kind of towards, you know, 30s, where I was thinking, I want to try going to university. So my sisters went to university. They both got degrees, seemed to enjoy it. And I just felt like it's almost like a box I've got to tick. Mm-hmm. So I went back and did an access to university course and then got on a media course in Birmingham. And I guess just started being a student and all that entails, you know, a mature student. So you're approaching it from a slightly different angle. You know, you're more interested, you're a bit more, I suppose, wise in your own way. And a bit more engaged
in the actual pursuit of it rather than, you know.
Yeah, and I did radio journalism. I also did digital imaging skills and things like that. I found that it really helped in certain areas. I thought some of it was rubbish, don't get me wrong. Some of it was by the by, considering how expensive it is to go to university. And it does leave people with quite a big debt. So I didn't think it was all great, but it did help me because it kind of expanded journalism skills, the idea of just being able to pop yourself into certain parts of the media at certain times. And I think the biggest thing with media stuff is having a bit of confidence. You know, I didn't have a lot of confidence. I do to get on stage and shout, but I wouldn't say I had a lot of confidence as a DJ because you know, I just didn't think it was my thing. I met Lars actually by accident. I bumped into him in at a club night, and he was just starting Kerrang Radio, or getting people together to do the station to start it up.
Yeah.
And it was just that kind of chance bump into someone, and he said he'd heard my name around, and somebody said I was into metal, extreme metal, hardcore punk, all this stuff. And I told him I was, and he just said, come over and we'll try you out for a show. But before that, when I left university, I was a bit worried about where my media degree was going to send me. And it actually sent me to making ringtones for mobile phones.
Please clarify this point. You weren't responsible for Crazy Frog, were you?
It was our best seller. not that I made it. I didn't make it. But it was our best seller.
That'd be a great story, wouldn't it?
It was the best-selling ringtone of 2000 or whatever it was. But we all remember those adverts, don't we, for mobile phone ringtones and pictures before you had a smartphone.
Of course.
Well, I was the poor guy after university sitting in a room with a keyboard making the top 20 in ringtone for. And so that's one of the things I've done as well. And it was from there that I went into Kerrang, because I met Lars while I was doing that job, and he said to come and start off, see if you can do a show. And I started off doing a specialist metal show, and then also just spread out onto other little shows and bits and bobs and things like that. But I definitely thought, this is a good place to be. I want to kind of see how far I can push it and see if I can, you know, do it well. That's it, really.
And I think, with Kerrang, did that when you first started at Kerrang, was that kind of like you were given free reign over your set list, over what you played on your shows? Were you part of the production team, or were you, you know, presented with a big list of records and gone, right, then pick from that lot? But what did that look like for you when you started?
No, it was totally my own choice, because I was given a specialist show. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're on in the day, if you do breakfast or you do drive time or in between that, you have playlisted stuff, you sure. know, in front of you. It's very varied. It's new stuff, it's old stuff, and you can maybe make a change and put something in. But when it gets to late night specialist shows, and we had a remit when we launched as well. We had a goth show, we had a metal show, which was me, an extreme metal show. We had a hip-hop show at one stage as well, mm-hmm. just because when Kerrang launched, it wasn't trying to be exactly like the magazine. It was trying to leave its remit a bit wider, actually, so it could play some indie if it needed to. It could interview as many bands who were in town as possible, who played guitars, you know. So it kind of upset some people in that the remit was a little bit wider, and then it also grew really, really fast, so lots of people started listening to it when it first launched, and it did a million listeners in a couple of years, you know, after it launched.
Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. And you're at a point now where you've got a great broadcasting career, wealth of experience as a musician. Tell me about those things combined and how that applies when you listen to Firstly for Leisure and what you look for in artists to help them, give them a platform. What you look, you know, when you're looking at yourself and your own past, how do you use that now to look for new music for your show in particular?
I think it's always going to be the biggest bands first, in a sense, because... Yeah. Because a lot of bands have really put the work in and they've had lots and lots of success and they've just, you know, they've done it already. So you tend to look for the big bands, but you also have to work out what's coming through, what's important, which is really difficult as well. It's all been made a lot more difficult by having the internet for various reasons, because it's a bit like when we had four channels on the television. And there were certain things that you could see, and then suddenly it went to 100 channels on your cable box, and you thought, God, there's too much stuff to even notice here. So it's a bit difficult these days trying to focus and also trying to get something that's really going to hit hard. You know, it's through the years we've had certain things that come through, whether it be glam rock, thrash, death metal had a good run in the 90s, grunge came through, of course. Then you had things like emo and scene bands, metalcore, you know, which the young people all got into. Mm-hmm. And lately we've had a new wave of classic rock, which I just didn't see happening. But, you know, the over 40s love it, the over 50s love it. And now some of the younger ones are doing their own classic rock bands, you know. So you can never know how it's going, but you just kind of look at the terrain and see what's coming through. I think it's got harder because so many people get in touch with me now, and I'm quite a nice guy. You know, I like to help bands if I can, and you just can't. Straight up can't, you know.
That's a very interesting thing that you're leading onto there, because that really comes onto my next point, was there'd be quite a few musicians watching this and keen to have some insight on how to connect, not just to be, you know, to be not just to sort of go, all right, Johnny, you know, play my song and stuff like that. But what's your top tips for first making contact with a radio station like Kerrang, for example? And secondly, building on that relationship, because it's all very well, you know, you send a single or you get a press agent, PR to send a record across to someone like yourself, for example. But then how best do you think artists can maintain that relationship without the pushiness, without the, you know, because we, you know, you get thousands of records a week pushed your way and you have to filter through that somewhat. Mm. How can they be seen above the rest? What are the things that you look for when you get communication with an artist?
A lot of younger bands are all over it already. They've got their kind of social network side of it, you know, where they'll post things to keep people updated, or TikTok or Instagram or whatever. Mm-hmm. They're so, you know, they've got Bandcamp, they've got SoundCloud, they've got all sorts of different ways of having music online. But then, of course, you know, you need something to show people these days as well. We live in a very visual age. A lot of people have got larger than life personas at the moment, especially females in music at the moment, you know. You only have to switch something on and, you know, people are, as I said, larger than life. So it's hard to make an impact, but you do tend to need some kind of video if you can. Mm-hmm. These days. And you don't need to waffle as well. Some people send you things and they go, well, Terry joined the band in 82 and then James joined, and
yeah, that Sarah death by left Wikipedia and, thing that I'll talk
you know
about.
It's just too much. And a lot of the time what you need is an email and go, here is the new single from UK metalcore band so and so, here's the YouTube link, here's the link to the radio edit of the single. And then you've got a good chance someone will just go, right, I'll click on it, click on the video, watch it straight away, and then if it appeals to them, then they'll download it and stick it on the show. But people don't want too much to read. And, you know, if you can be as snappy as possible in this day and age, I think it does help.
Mm-hmm. And how do you feel about engagement in through the medium of a story as such, albeit short, you know, a few paragraphs, which we do. We basically get artists to engage with their stories first and then use those stories to market, you know, what they believe, who they are, give you a greater sense of their identities.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes the surrounding information is what makes it interesting. You know, it might be that the people are making a song about mental health or about a tragedy that happened in their lives or something. Mm-hmm. You know, anything to give it personality. I mean, or mystique, really. That's one of the things lacking from music these days, is that you can see too much of each other.
Yeah.
And you're too accessible. So it's creating something that's evocative, that, you know, piques people's interest and maybe is a bit mysterious these days as well. Although I couldn't tell you the magic formula. You know, it's hard. People do say to me, you know, what could I do to get my band out there more? And there's some absolutely phenomenal bands who've got videos out there and amazing work that's produced brilliantly. And they still have trouble because it's it's getting that winning formula and it's very evasive.
It is, and no one truly has the answer. We just have to give people the best opportunity through our own experiences and you know, and thought, really. And again, with radio, this is a real simple question, really. We are where we are at the moment with radio. You know, it's been that invisible friend on the nightstand to keep us company, that romantic notion of radio. But with the, you know, with the increasing input from technology, where do you see radio going in the next 20 years?
Yeah, I've been thinking about this, obviously. Sorry, I'm just going to cough. yeah, I've been thinking about this quite a lot because obviously you have to think about your own industry. And it's a bit like magazines. You know, I grew up worshipping Kerrang. You know, it was just easy to read. It came out weekly when the others came out monthly. Mm-hmm. You could always go to the reviews section and find something exciting that you wanted to listen to. You know, and Kerrang, a lot of people slag it off. A lot of people give it a hard time, but it really covered a lot of ground back then. Everything from AOR to thrash to death. It all went through the pages of Kerrang. And I used to read magazines called Metal Forces, Mega Metal Kerrang, and Raw Power, and then Terrorize the magazine. And I started writing for a magazine, Zero Tolerance as well, which is still going. Mm. But yeah, you know, magazines were the same. They're your go-to. You read about all the new stuff that's coming out. You get excited. You look at the pictures. And now that's kind of been taken over by the internet. And radio's still got a following because some people like to have a voice in the room, someone telling them, you know, when gigs are happening or relating some rock news, a few funny stories, and to, you know, that relatability. People still like radio for that, you know, whether it's commercial radio, dance radio, rock radio, specialist stuff like Six Music, you know, people still seem to enjoy having that thing to be able to put on. But also the competition's there, you know, you've got YouTubers and podcasters and internet radio stations, and anyone with a mic and a broadband signal can kind of get involved. So then it goes back to the punk rock level again, where everyone's doing it. And the tough bit then is to be able to stick your head above the water and say, I'm doing it better than the next guy.
Sure.
or I'm the one to listen to, you know. But it's happened with rock music as well. You know, things have gone from the days of mega stars and then lowly fans. Now there's a big thriving kind of pub community, a local band scene, you know, where it's almost emulating punk rock again, going out of the academies and back into the pubs and things like that, you know, with lots of grassroots bands kind of doing the circuit, you know, which is interesting to see. But we also need some mega stars as well. And there are bands that are pushing through at the moment who are exciting and picking up lots of fans, whether it's Sleep Token or Spirit Box or Ginger, or, you know, all sorts of bands coming out, and there's hardcore stuff and death metal and black metal as well. All that's thriving. So yeah, rock and metal, however much it fluctuates in the media or however popular it is, it seems like it's all based around the fans' need for music and their excitement around bands. So radio will continue if people want to hear us talking about those bands, but I could see it phasing out, you know, over time.
It's a possibility. And now, obviously, we've managed to avoid the phrase post-COVID until now. The impact, we have to reflect on this for a moment, has been horrendous and still is.
Yeah.
Totally horrendous. It's a shitstorm at the minute. Do you see the light at the end of the tunnel with this? And what do you see happening going forward? Final question, really.
I do see light at the end of the tunnel because we've got a lot of intelligent people out there, a lot of scientific people working behind the scenes. And, but, you know, unfortunately, we've also got quite a lot of idiots out there as well. A lot of people who are very easily led, a lot of people who seem to believe anything they read on the internet, which seems to be getting in the way of us making a smooth traction back to normality. You know, it's all these people who seem to think they know better than scientists who have done umpteen years at medical school and sat there with giant books reading. And but anyway, so yeah, there's lots of foolish people out there who seem to be latching onto things, whether it's the lockdown just sent them down a lot of rabbit holes and they don't like thinking for themselves. But yeah, COVID at the moment, I think it's something, as you say, it's quite a big thing. It's never happened in my lifetime, everything shutting down or having to be locked down. But I can understand it, you know, when I look at the kind of scientific and medical approach to it. So I've had both my vaccines, you know, so I'm not worried about that. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's risks, you know, there can never be 100% proof that something doesn't have risks attached to it. But again, thousands of the best scientists have worked on this more than ever to try and race out something that can help at least curb the nasty symptoms. So I do urge people listening out there to not listen to foolishness and maybe take the vaccine and trust in your fellow people and help them out. Wear a mask even if you can and stay safe, because we don't know, you know, we don't know until figures are going to change. Obviously, I want to see everything back out there. Download Pilot Festival was good, wasn't it? We had fun there.
A huge success, yes.
And I think that was fairly safe. I didn't see mass records of people having COVID. They did a lateral flow test. And I think some of the festivals are going to be doing that this year, you know, Slam Dunk Festival and things like that. So that seems sensible. So, yeah, I think it's a case of not believing fairy stories and looking around and looking after your neighbours and the people that matter, really. And I think the sooner we all do that and listen to the people who are really, truly working on it, then we'll get through it. We'll find better vaccines and we'll find better ways to combat it, because it's like anything. It's like flu. It's like other COVID viruses that have been around for years as well. It's just a different variant. And well done to all the people who've been working hard and looking after patients and things like that. You know, hats off to them working in masks in really hot hospitals, you know. So, you know, they definitely need our support. But, yeah, that's how I think we're going to get through it, Adam. And fingers crossed.
Oh, I'll keep my fingers crossed. Johnny, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure to be in your company. It's lovely to see you again, and I'll probably see you again in a couple of weeks' time. But for now, Mr. Johnny Doom, ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you, Adam, and everyone out there, stay safe.